become one of the biggest heavy acts on earth when they rarely do interviews, have only ever appeared in one of their videos, and don't get played on the radio? How does a band take a five-year break from recording and return with a worldwide number one album and sell millions of records in the process? The answer lies with Los Angeles band Tool, who have always played by their own rules and have been massively successful as a result. Of course, Tool don't reveal too much, preferring to let their music do the talking, and talk it does. Over the next 60 minutes, we'll play every Tool video ever made and also catch up with the band in two exclusive interviews, asking them about their music, their fear of exploitation, and why the band refuses to play by the book. First, let's travel back to 1992, when Tool emerged with the Opiate EP, a record that sounded like nothing else released that year or any other. The video for Hush featured the one and only appearance of the band making a rare public statement. Can you guess what's pissing them off? You're watching a very Tool special. Tool were officially born in 1991 when guitarist Adam Jones, who at the time was a sculptor and special effects designer for the Terminator and Predator movies, met ex-soldier Maynard James Keenan. They joined up with Keenan's neighbour, drummer Danny Carey, and bassist Paul D'Amore. Tool has always been an odd mix of characters, as Jones told Channel V earlier this year.
We're four different people, and we all have different tastes, and it's just kind of about the chemistry of, you know, where it meets in the middle. And it's, there's enough consideration and respect about, you know, trying stuff and actually trying to excite each other in an experimental way that it's very rewarding.
Despite their differences, Tool have stuck together with only one lineup change in the band's decade together, as their counterparts from the early 90s such as Soundgarden, Nirvana and the Smashing Pumpkins have fallen by the wayside.
It is satisfying just to know that we were, like, had the strength and I guess the courage to maintain a relationship with each other. Because, I mean, it's tough. It's tough to stay married just with a person for 10 years, let alone stay married to three people, you know, for 10 years, you know. It's hard. We've had one change along the way. But it's all worked out, you know, and
worked out for the better.
Yeah.
The one change in Tool's history was the departure of bassist Paul D'Amore in September 95. He was immediately replaced by Justin Chancellor, former member of UK band Peach. Chancellor has his own thoughts on keeping a band together.
Having a lot of respect for each other and respecting each other's ideas and keeping an open mind.
Yeah. I think keeping, you know, that white-hot vision of the end product in mind, that's, I mean, it's worth suffering through each other's, you know, pet peeves and all that stuff, you know, if you know what the end product is going to be, and it's so rewarding, you know. That's why we're still together. If that wasn't there, we would have kicked each other's asses ages ago and broke up or whatever. You know?
In 93, Tool released their debut full-length album, Undertow, which sold in the hundreds of thousands in the first 12 months of release. One of the highlights of Undertow was the song Prison Sex, a song Keenan has hinted relates to abuse he suffered as a child. The clip for Prison Sex, directed by guitarist Adam Jones, set standards for Tool clips to come. It featured the stop-motion camera techniques that he had developed with his work in film. You're watching an hour of Tool on Channel V. Tool have always been an elusive band, both visually and lyrically, which has led the songs of Maynard James Keenan open to interpretation.
People make their own choices. That's bottom line. I think, to me, it's kind of like
those kind of frustrations, that kind of social frustration that that comes about, people lashing out, it's because of unaddressed aggressions, repressed emotions, that kind of stuff. So to me, when you see some movie about somebody just doing some horrific deeds, in a way, by watching the movie, you have related to and expressed that emotion or that desire, and therefore you don't need to go do it. And kind of like, it's like, you know, kind of letting the steam out in a way. But the more you repress it and deny it, the more it's going to come up somewhere, and it's not going to be pretty when it happens, and it'll be real when it happens rather than just, you know, a book or story or a film or a song. So I think it's important because it doesn't, you know, we have all those nasty things that you read about or come up with or see in a film or hear about in a song. Those are in you. And if you deny that those things are in you, they're going to come, they're going to bite you.
In 1996, Tool released their second full-length album, Enema. It established them as one of the biggest heavy bands in the world, spawning a devoted audience across the globe. And how do Australian and New Zealand crowds measure up?
They seem to be more intelligent.
Yeah, they're really passionate, and but they're not as, you know, knuckleheaded, you know, as the fans here, which I consider myself knuckleheaded, so... It's just a lot more, like they're going nuts, but they're still really respectful at our shows, you know.
For a band as heavy as Tool, their shows have remained strangely peaceful affairs, unlike some of their contemporaries.
We see diversity in the crowds, that's for sure. You know, but it does have a good communal vibe, it seems like, at most of the venues we've been to, and it's worked out really well so far. We don't want to end up in any crazy incidents, you know, that have happened at some of these big festivals, you know, where people are getting crushed or something, you know, so but it hasn't ever gone that direction at all with us, so it's good. I'm really happy about that.
So, how does Tool command such a devoted following?
Well, we set the precedent right away. Our music isn't necessarily something that you just put on and tap your foot to. It's definitely more of an interactive process, so right away, the entire fan base that we've developed over the last 10 years, it's been those kind of people, and kind of spread out from there. So we set the precedent initially. It wasn't about jumping up and down to some catchy phrase. It was about connecting with the music, listening, and respecting these people as artists, and listening with an artist's ears. So, you know, I would say the majority of our crowd are, they're artists in their own way. So they have respect for what we do. They're very forgiving. They listen with their hearts rather than just show up like cattle because you get a free toy with this Happy Meal.